Okay, welcome back after the coffee break. Looks like we've lost one panel member here, but this is a discussion time. We have a lot of time until 12 o'clock to discuss the issues that the panelists raised. There's a lot to discuss. Clearly, the three South Caucasian republics have a similar problems, similar tasks. Many cases have taken different solutions, different policies, but some of the themes that I heard were the issue of autonomy for higher education, the problems of equity, problems of access, issues of regional cooperation, the problem of the connection between research and development with economic reality, those connections and the contribution that higher education can make to economic development. And these are all clearly very important issues for the three developing economies in the South Caucasus. So, I would like to open discussion. I'm sure you have questions. Two of our panelists are here to answer some of those questions, but I guess it will be more of a conversation between us. And I'd like to hand it over to anybody on the floor who would like to start the discussion. We have a microphone here.
Distribute funding when these are such small communities. How do you make sure that these decisions are made in an objective manner in terms of distribution of funding and projects because of the problems of network?
Among university, you mean between? It's not so clear if you a little clarify.
You need to fund some research projects, right? How do you select research projects
funding research?
Yes. When the research community is so small and it's very difficult to have objective
evaluation. Expertise and
thank you very much. It's not a great problem, unfortunately, because you have said research community is not so big, not so high. Universities are just looking for researchers. That's why in many areas we invite professors from abroad, from different countries, if they would join to university, not just for teaching, but for to develop capacity of research capacity. So the university has some two types of funding. I mean, in case of my university. One is general salary for just researchers, or if you are good researcher with PhD with publishing, your salary will be much more higher than general teachers. Second one, for every publishing article, we're giving some concrete money to researchers. If you are publishing in, let me say, Thomson Reuters type of journals, for each publishing, depending on some impact factor, you are receiving some money from university funding. Also, we have some university industry relations like BP and our university. For good researchers, this industry sometimes giving some special awards or some kind of programs to develop research capacity.
to define two types of funding in this regard. So when if we speak about state funding system, actually we have a special budget allocated in our budget, state budget. We have a special body operating within the Ministry of Education and Science. It's a state committee on science. We have a special procedure for applying for every research project. It can be a science, it can be an educational institution. We have approximately 50 research and scientific centers in Armenia, by the way. When we talk about funding from other or other funding tools, like for instance Horizon 2020, which I think is one of the best funding systems for EU and non-EU countries. Unfortunately, Armenia is just the associated member for Horizon 2020. Why? Because the fee for being a partner is too high. Now we are negotiating with EU for making this participation fee less for Armenia, taking into account the GDP. I don't know whether, and I'm interested whether the Georgia is a member of Horizon 2020, because they have a special procedure for selection of all research projects, and you may win or not, but you have to pay this participation fee, which is much more higher than is allocated for participation, the participation in such kind of project which are settled in our budget. But if we are talking about state funding, yes, we have a budget, we have a special procedure which was adopted by the decree of government. So with special timetable, they announce the budget, they announce the regulation, and if the project is in framework and is according to this regulation, they receive a budget which is actually limited.
I will add that Azerbaijani government funding to higher education institution, only 0.4% is for research, too meager. That's why university, particularly private university, increasing their research capacity, also university, as I said, university industry relations, even for PhD scholarship and international programs.
Thank you. I wonder if I may add to that and ask a question about research funding. One of the things that came across from all three presentations was that there are an abundance of universities and research institutes in the South Caucasus. So I think Cameron, you mentioned the fact that there were something like 52 universities in Azerbaijan. I don't know how many there are in Armenia. Pierre mentioned 42 research institutes in Georgia, as well as four major universities.
If we speak about research universities, there are approximately 50.
50?
Yeah, 50. Yeah, higher education institutions, private and state. So we have approximately 16 state and 42 private.
So my question would be, are we actually stretching things too thin because we have so many institutions? I mean, if you look at European countries and you look at the ratio between university research institutes and the population, you will see that in the South Caucasus, you have to spread the funding much more thinly because you have so many more research institutes to fund. So would this be a place to look in terms of trying to consolidate the number of research institutions in order to create more concentrated funding for those institutions that work well, rather than try and spread that funding over so many? It's an unusual situation in the South Caucasus from that point of view, that you have so many for such a small population.
With my microphone, but you know, actually, yes, maybe there are too many, but you know, the state budget gives the minimum which is necessary for these universities. It is not enough, actually, But if you are a good researcher or scientific, there are many tools for applying for additional financing. So if you are a good researcher, you find money from another tools, from another international organizations, like European, American funding system. We have some ethnic systems as well for research. And I know that many researchers and scientists receive even more money from another tools than from the state budget.
I would say that probably in most South Caucasian countries, research is not priority area for governments, unfortunately. They would say education is priority area. They're spending money for education, but not for research. For instance, we have Academy of Science, former Soviet type of Academy of Science. They have some, maybe more than 20 research institutes, but their capacity is too, right? And no reform. Government is just giving small money salary for these people, not taking into account who is good researcher, who is not just a researcher. That's why I'm not joining them with university. It is separate some unit. That's why also there is no definition, formal definition, according to classification of universities, that this is research-oriented university, this is teaching university. Yeah. Just universities have some ambition. They are not a research-oriented university. If you look for publishing, many of them are not research-oriented. So situation, there is an uncertainty. That's why only few universities which have some international body of teachers, some international standing, some international ranking they are entering. They indeed they are working on research capacity increasing, but not it's for the whole country, for the government. Let me say.
You know, one of the main principles of Bologna process is the autonomy of higher education institutions. So it means that higher education institution has to decide what is development for that education institution. So I think that in any case, research and science is the priority, not only for the government, because it is really one of the priorities for the government of Republic of Armenia, but for the higher education institution itself. So if they think and if they realize that the research, the research and science is the one of the huge step toward the development, they make a priority for that higher education institution and work in this direction. So this is the autonomy of higher education institution. They have to decide what they have to do. Not the government, not the ministry, because they run that education institution. If the research is one of the huge steps toward the development of this, yes, they have to be in a good run with international development for research. And that is why I have mentioned that there are many tools which can be applied by higher education institutions itself. For instance, Warsaw 2020, which has a huge budget. And if the project is really the best one, it cannot be not selected, yes? So you just have to submit the appropriate level for your project. It's an issue of capacity, it's an issue of skills, but I think that if you are a good researcher, you have to submit all requirements, not just receive a fund and that's it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, did you want to come back on that at all?
If I may, I have still another issue related to Horizon 2020, because I think it's very important. I was myself involved in evaluating the project, so I know some insider.
Yeah, can you speak up? Because I don't have a microphone.
One of the problems is that almost no projects whatsoever are initiated from the region. So it is mostly Western partners who initiate projects, and the local institutions just are involved getting little money and almost no benefit from the project. Are there any sort of initiatives to promote that local institutions start initiating such projects? Because otherwise there is absolutely no use of this, other than just keeping institutions getting small money. Normally it's about 30, 50, 80,000 euros, and that's it. I remember only one of the project, research project that was initiated from here, and it failed, unfortunately.
Yes, I'm sorry, by saying here, you mean Georgia, or you mean the region?
From the region, yes.
From the region.
Yes.
If I'm not mistaken, Armenia had, so in Horizon 2020, you can be an associate partner as well. So you can be a part of one huge project, and make a small research in a whole project. So if I'm not mistaken, Armenia had participated in three of them, and they received the money for three of them. But for participating in a number of more projects, you have to be not an associate member, but a fully participant of this project. But the participation fee is too high for this stage. That is why we are in the process of negotiation. Because you know, the participation fee is approximately a sum for financing of five scientific institutions annually. So it's better to finance five scientific institutions in your country than to participate without knowing whether you win or not.
Okay, any other questions for the panelists? Take this. Could everybody just give their names when they contribute and tell me what institution they're from? Is it not working?
Now I think it's working.
Yeah.
My name is Simon Janashi. I'm from Georgia, but I'm doing my PhD in University of Columbia. And my question is to Mr. Isaxanli. You mentioned that there is a transition now to the per capita funding system in higher education. And here we, as you may know, we have had this system during probably 4 years. And then it started transition, and now the transition is back to the program way of funding universities. And there are some arguments against it, the per capita, that it creates unintended market consequences inside the universities that negatively affects the quality of higher education. So, for example, some ministry officials that I've listened to, they think that universities are trying to lower their quality in order to retain students, and therefore they need to change the system of financing back to the program way. The second argument is that they need to prioritize what the government wants to develop in the country, and need to have the areas that they want to fund. And therefore now, during the last 3 years, there are some majors that are funded here fully without competing. And only in the state universities also, which is really strange, and only in the universities that have the programs in the same areas that have the funding in the MBA. So what is your rationale of going towards the project?
Thank you. Government is not supporting research, I think, due to two reasons. One is that, as I said, their idea is that education is very important. Inside education, you have to do research, you have PhD program and so on. So it's not priority. Second, their idea is that everywhere, even in the United States, government funding to universities is decreasing. Universities they have their own responsibility for fundraising. According to the, you have to sell your research. You have to have university industry relations. If you have very good research idea, please send your proposal. They created recently National Science Foundation. Seems very good name. And another foundation is National High Tech Foundation. National Science Foundation is affiliated with President Administration. National High Tech Foundation is affiliated with Minister of High Tech, Communication and High Tech. Indeed, they have developed some grant system for competition. Particularly, this high tech, they have capacity to give some maximum $300,000 per project, but they started just now. The problem, another side of the problem is that indeed universities have, many universities have no capacity good research, applied research. For instance, we had program with BP. It was some kind of training program for BP employee, and they then sent some their problems concerning petroleum engineering. That if you look for this problem, you may earn money from BP 10 times more than the problem. Our petroleum engineering department, they have discussed it. Indeed, they understood what is the problem. But to enter into the solution, our capacity was not enough. We invited three professors from abroad to join our team. Now we are working. So not only, it's not right way to say that government is not giving money. Universities have no capacity to money in this sense. But anyway, I think in countries like Southern Caucasus, government policy is very important. I will give example from Turkey. Last year, Times Higher Education, 400 best universities, they have 6 universities. It's fantastic. What is the reason? Because they have fantastic research funding. First, each university receiving separate sub around 10% of budget oriented to research. Every publishing, if you will publish in Thomson Reuters Index, you are receiving for each publishing between $1,000 and $3,000 net for each publishing. Also, for most universities developing a scholarship program, PhD scholarship program, and their government research funding, name is Tubitak, supporting, they have double supporting for PhD program, university itself and this science foundation. So for the countries of the former Soviet, which they are not so interested to give, to prioritize research, anyway, we have to try to negotiate with government that it's very important. At the same time, to develop capacity, and it will be pressing for ministries and other government agencies that you see, we have research capacity, we can solve this or that problem. So it's some kind of two sides that they have to come together, increasing research capacity inside of academia, and understanding of research funding from government side. There is, I said, some kind of thread, some kind of movement, but it is beginning. That's why even you will apply for this science foundation. Procedure is not lack of transparency and not easy to understand.
Angelina, would you like to comment on that?
Just, you know, if I may speak on behalf of some university, first issue I would mention again funding, that the funding is not enough, the funding I mean which is allocated in budget. But maybe it is the minimum which is provided. So the government in this regards helps not to stand, but how to flow and how fast to flow. Maybe it's a more mental capacity of that university. So I have mentioned that we have developed a ranking system, and one of the main issues is research and science. If the research and science is priority for that university, you have to apply, you have to work, you have to develop your capacity, skills. Because unfortunately, many scientific persons, they are not in ongoing science. To be considered as a science and to be a science, indeed, it's a separate story, I think. So you have to be, and you have to have a modern some skills. If you are not on this board, it means you are outside. This is the main problem for me for research. Again, funding, but this is also the issue, and you have to submit some criteria. Funding, you can have a funding, but if you don't spend it or you cannot manage it to put it on the right project, it is also an issue. And I think that it's a matter of management. It's a matter of researching research. Funding is, again, very important, but it's not the only issue.
Did that answer your question? Do you want to make an additional comment? No?
Yeah, but my question was about slightly different. It was about the funding of universities in general, not just science, but it is very interesting. Hear about how about the different ways that could be introduced both on the organization and on the state level. But I totally agree that unless you can trace how much government is spending on science, you cannot say really that the government is interested in science. And if universities, if none of the universities have priority to do the research, that will result into a country not having research. So that's, I think it's obvious.
You mean inside the university policy funding? What kind of difference?
Okay, so, I mean, clearly one of the problems here is how do you convince governments in the South Caucasus that education actually is important and vital to economic progress, economic development, national security, all these sorts of issues. Clearly, you know, when you look at the budgets of South Caucasian governments for funding of research in the South Caucasus, it's very, very small. But the question that might follow from this is, clearly it's important that research is developed in these countries, but to what degree can these small countries compete in a globalized world with all the excellence and funding that you find in Europe and the United States and other Western countries? You know, where can the South Caucasus, in some sense, develop its skills and its particular ideas? Where can it fit into this globalized world of skill and knowledge? It's a big question, I know.
In this regard, I can speak about many mobility tools which are for science and for researchers, for instance, my theory action Erasmus Plus. So we have announced the program, and in many programs we have a very few number of participants. So it's not the issue of money again. But I know that the funding is not enough for the development. But if you want to develop some project, you, first of all, you have to be interested in presenting it. Unfortunately, in many programs, there is no presentation from scientists. Knowing that this project has a funding system, or you can organize a mobility for your researchers, and the university to not apply. It's not the issue of just Armenia. I have noticed, and this is the same situation is in many of European partners, in Eastern Partnership countries. We announced the program and we received no application, for instance, from one of the countries. But when we were talking about it, they say, you know, we don't have the capacity, this university, the scientists are not so mobilized, they are not so involved in ongoing project, and it's difficult to move them.
In Azerbaijan, government has easy money, selling oil and gas. That's why maybe one of the reasons that maybe they, after some years there will come the conclusion that you have to develop some research, and because it is knowledge economy and so on. Of course, in government declaration they are telling about it, knowledge economy, important of that, but in acting, indeed, selling oil and gas gives big money for state budget. For instance, this year, government spending budget to education was $1,600,000. It's good enough for this time. At the same time, as I said, 0.4 is only for research. Also, why university are not interested in research, increasing research capacity? Because in competition here, there is an accreditation committee and competition and so on. But as a result of accreditation, as a result of competition, nobody is receiving more money for research capacity. This just you have a good ranking, but what is the reason? And one more reason, I think that university governance, university governance is not like in Europe or in United States, because there is a rector appointed in this case of state university, rector appointed by president of country. So rector is much more powerful person than rector in United States. For instance, rector in United States is more powerful than in Europe. But I think rector in Azerbaijan is more powerful, because appointed by president, nobody will move. Only president one day they can. That's why there is no board of trustees type of, or board of regents, which is intermediary between university and stakeholder, who will make policy, research and evaluation, what you have to appreciate or not. So anyway, problem again is multi-sided.
Yes, so I guess what Angelina said is, and this is something I had a conversation with Gere during the break, and Gere emphasized the fact that this is not simply a question of funding, it is also a question of governance, right? Administration. Not only in terms of how funding is managed by the state, but also how the university is managed internally. Right? I mean, these are vital issues that determine success or not. Right?
You know, in this regard, I would like to mention that in Armenia, actually, the rectors are selected. So we have a special procedure of election for the candidate of, actually, at the end, it is nominated by the minister. But he or she has to submit the procedure of election. And now we are in the process of transferring the state universities to so-called national foundations, which will give them more possibilities for self-financing and self-government. So if the university is autonomous and if he is free, he has to use this freedom. Freedom is the tool which is not, which is very, I don't know, serious tool. If you want to be free, you have to organize your work and you have to govern. You have to take the responsibility for your freedom, is my opinion.
Any other questions? Yes.
Can I just?
Yeah, please. Could you tell us who you are, where you're from?
Is it on? Yeah, thanks. Hi, I'm Jane Greenwood. I'm currently the chairperson of architecture and interior design at Prince Sultan University in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. So coming from an institution that's very rich in oil money also. My question, I'd like to focus a little bit on one theme that I kind of saw between the three presentations had to do with the students. How do you increase accessibility, bringing in international students, local students, and then you mentioned the ranking system of the universities that you were trying to develop. And my question is, what are students looking for when they choose a university in the South Caucasus? Because when you have so many, that's one thing, there's a lot of public universities, there's a lot of private universities, there's a lot of competition, I would imagine, between those universities. So what are the students looking for? How are students making the decision about which university they want to attend or the subject that they want to study?
Yeah, we have approximately, this recent academic year, approximately 120,000 students. Actually, we have Armenian students and overseas students. I think overseas students, we can divide two categories. So foreigners and foreign students, so citizens of other countries, but Armenian by their region. The entrance to the higher education institutions of students for overseas students are made by the ministry. We have approximately 6,000 overseas students. Most of them come from Iran, Syria, India, and you know, every country has its special interest in studying in Armenia. For instance, if we speak about Indian students, they are mostly interested in medical university. So the medical university of Armenia is one of the best, and it gives them possibility to work in India. Students, you know, they have their own priorities. Come from the possibility of work after graduating from the university. So if we talk about Iran, it's again medical or architecture and design. Most of them are interested, and not only overseas students, but local students as well, in studying at state universities. We have a state university with different large branch of faculties. And the priority, and you know, maybe the time, they follow some, I don't know, modern specialized professions. For instance, 5 years before it was a law, everyone wants to be a lawyer. Now there is a huge interest in IT sector. And I can say that we have universities like Synopsis, like polytechnic universities, we had developed with the, by means of US supporting the scientific laboratory. And IT sector is rather developed in Armenia, and we have a huge application for IT sector now. So if we talk about priorities among the students, my opinion is that education in any class must be student-oriented. So we work for students, and this is the main goal, not only for the ministry, not only for the institution, but for the students themselves. They somehow do not realize that they are the subject for education. Our universities and our students are rather open. We have student communities. They are very active. There is a link between Armenian students living in Armenia and Armenian students of diaspora or overseas students. We are not so open for some countries. So in some cases, we have to apply for Ministry of Foreign Affairs for make some students study possibly in Armenia. Overseas students are studying in Armenia mostly on tuition fee principle, so they have to pay, but the salary is not so high. It is actually higher than for Armenians. But we have a special budget allocated for free seats as well. So if we have a bilateral agreement with a number of countries, and if the candidate is presented by the ministry of that country, for instance, Georgia. Let's take Georgia. We have an intergovernmental agreement with Georgia. And annually, we provide 10 seats at any state university they apply. And the same is Georgian side for Armenians. So if the candidate is nominated by the ministry, they can apply for free tuition-free study. They receive monthly loans and also can obtain for a student dormitory. So I think that it's, in any case, a good example for cooperation and for involvement of overseas students. Also, we have a program for sending our students to other countries. I'm not talking about Erasmus Mundus, or Erasmus Mundus previously, but again, within the bilateral agreements, we make an application. We have many students, Armenian students, which are studying in other countries by support of the ministry. We have cooperation on mobility programs with Russia. And by the way, one of the priority program for our students is China. For we announced the scholarship program and application, and they have to pass some exams. So the same exams as they were applying to study for Armenia. If you're obtaining for bachelor, you have to pass exam. If you're obtaining to master, you will take into consideration your overage marks. And then to PhD. For China, for 25 seats, we had approximately 500 applications from the students. So I think that in one hand, it's not good enough, but they are open enough for new projects, for new countries, and by signing the bilateral agreements, I think that we support our students and give them possibility to study.
Thank you. In Azerbaijan, many universities have some international students, but I think some five or six of them attract much more international students than others. It depends, of course, first if you have quality of your programs, some international standing ranking system,
and they're looking for your teacher body. Let me say, in my university, School of Engineering, more than half of faculty members are international, because you cannot have good researchers in all fields of engineering or taking into account your own professors. That's why this school has much more, this school is much more, has international faculty member, much more international students than any other schools in Azerbaijan, including other schools of our university. So you have to look for quality, you have to look for international border, for ranking. Also, students' tuition fee is very important. We have developed some scholarship programs. Each country in the world developed two students. They may apply for PhD, for master, or for undergraduate. There is a committee who is deciding who is best. The rest will, if they are interested, they will come pay tuition. Which is not so high. Of course, it's also one of the reasons that why students coming to this country, because in our case it is the net for $5,000 per year. It's attractive for many students. Concerning students' body, we have students from North America, mainly PhD and master students from Europe. From Europe, mainly the exchange. We have some permanent students, but at the same time, most of European Erasmus students are coming to our university for different departments. Also, of course, we have students from Asian and African countries, from former Soviet countries, more from Asian countries. But just now, if you will, say about statistics, we have probably half Europe, Asia, half North America and Africa. But if we look at another statistics, that 5 years ago we had, I mean Azerbaijan, not university, Azerbaijan have more international students than now. The main reason is that almost half of international students were from Turkey, because we have no language and cultural barriers. That was, and Turkey that time has not enough number of universities, but now they increased dramatically number of universities in every region, so they have their own universities, which is, some of them are very good, some of them are not bad. So a number of students from Turkey is not so high now, but number of students from Iran is increasing rapidly.
Thank you. Let me tell you that in the United States there are similar problems of funding, and the role of international students play a very big role. Obviously it's on a different scale, but my own university, for example, now relies very strongly on the Chinese market in order to fund the operating budget of the university. And I can tell you, if it wasn't for Chinese students, our economics department would collapse, because we have so many Chinese students in that particular department. So, I mean, one of the issues here that seems to be developing also is the idea of the students themselves, which is the question you raised. You know, what is the capacity of students to learn when they get to the university? And this, of course, connects us with the larger problem of the educational system down to the elementary level. You know, universities do depend on adequately skilled students, prepared students when they come to university. You know, how is that connection between higher education and the schooling system generally? And how can universities, for example, help in developing and preparing students for university education? It seems to be an enormous problem in the South Caucasus.
I don't think that it is think it's prompted maybe. Oh.
Yeah, yes.
Actually, in Armenia, so we had the system of elections, and for applying to the university, which is came from post-Soviet, mostly selected system. So after finishing the secondary school, the pupils are electing several educational institutions by order. Where do they want to apply? So first of all, they are free to decide whether they want to continue to our education or not. In Armenia, we have approximately 67% of pupils which are applying to higher education, which I think is one of the best examples in the world, because our pupils are interested in receiving higher education. And it is you know, not only the priority for the pupil, but for the parents. Because in Armenia, parents are eager that their child has to obtain and has to apply for higher education. So they have final exams in the school. We have a special committee at, which is in charge of this selection procedure. So they organize the general exams on the whole territory of the Republic of Armenia. And they select the university. The best one can apply for free seats. So we have a number of free seats for studying in higher educational institutions. So if the marks are high, they study tuition free. If the marks are lower, they have to pay. And I think this is one of the best examples how can you divide and how the best can study without paying. And I think that this model is really working. So in this regard, university is not choosing. It can be more attractive for the people, but they decide where to apply. And if the marks are high, they have their free seats, and the funding is from budget, not from the university, but is allocated. So we have annually special decrees with the number of free seats. Besides, we also have an issue of military service. So if you are not in the free seats system, you have to pass military service and then come back to your study.
In Azerbaijan, Azerbaijani government pays much more attention to reform in secondary school system than in higher education and other areas. I think in this case, government is right because high school is very important. And one of the main areas of reform is training of teachers and administrators. Because if you have not good teachers, not good administrators, how will reform, how will increase quality? And my university, Khazar University, is probably most developed in receiving government money to train this school administrators and teachers. It's subject teaching, curriculum development, administrators capacity, increasing capacity, and so on in most of areas. Also, main idea is that each school, they have to have some philosophy, which is at least a little different from neighbor school, and have good teachers. My university has created its own school, affiliated with our school of education. It's some kind of lab school, which is name is Dunya School, World School, which is indeed famous in the country. He became also IB school, International Baccalaureate School. Recently, president of country included it into 50 best school in the country. So we're working all time. It's very important what is the situation in
secondary schools, how they will move with what kind of skills into higher education, because sometimes they're coming to higher education with different psychology. Because due to a central examination system, last 2 years, probably students are, students of high school. They are not interested to go to class. They will go to a teacher which will prepare individual. And what coming to universities, they have no some kind of collective identity. Our psychology department is have some interesting projects. What is the matter? Why they are coming so different? It's not easy to accommodate with the university system, lecturing and so. So also one of the problem is that both in higher education, in high school, system is teacher centered. While of course all time emphasizing developing ideas, philosophies that student-centered system is very important, but student-centered system establish this system is not so easy because teachers were educated as teacher-centered. They are product of teacher-centered system. You will ask them, please do your student-centered system. That's why one of the, as a philosopher, if our training system is trying to change this system.
Other questions?
I'm Natalia Khazar, Academician of ARISC Academy in Tbilisi. And I have worked for over 15 years as a patent specialist in technology in Tbilisi. And later I moved to the conflicts, inter-ethnic conflict resolution things. I have a question to the guest from, to the speaker from Baku. Yeah, well, you said that it is your university, and so the name of your university, Khazar University, I have my opinion, but what would you say? Why did you name this? Why did you give this name? What is Khazar?
Khazar means Caspian, because Baku is located on Caspian Sea. In Eastern languages like Turkish, Azerbaijani, Arabic, Persian, its name is Khazar. If you remember, it was Khazar Khaganate in southern Caucasus. When Arabs came to Caucasus, they named this sea Khazar Sea because they have met with Khazar people. It was 100-year war between Arabs and Khazar who will rule Caucasus. And Khazar is some kind of part of Azerbaijani culture. Many songs, many songs. That's why we name.
I
was
sure you would say that. And you all three, I'm sure, are well aware of the roots of the problems and wars, the inter-ethnic wars in the area. And just one of the reasons is just the isolation. Well, before it was Khazar, which, well, Khazar has nothing to do with Azerbaijan, whether that was called Azerbaijani in our language, in historical data, and Azerbaijani was not there, now is, but it was in another area, and it was created much later, thousand millennia later, than our related population was there. Well, I have brought just a map printed in Paris by a famous map maker, Sanson, and it was copied for the King of Portugal to teach his sons, and well, Georgia is from one sea to the Caspian Lake. I can give it to you. It is on the internet, and it is in Paris, in the library. There are many maps made, both printed both here in Moscow, in Lenin, in Leningrad, in the Soviet times. And, well, you all know very well that. But the thing is that it is hushed, and most problems arise from the falsification of history, invention of new unexistent nationalities, especially in Soviet times. And well, it is some dear professors, some dead already, some alive, that are bullmongers.
Right. Thank you very much. Any other questions? We have approximately 15 minutes, so take your opportunity. Okay.
Unfortunately, we haven't received any information about Georgian system of financing, so if anyone can answer about the system of financing or system of higher education, that would be, I think, very useful.
Second part, they will have two speakers from Georgia.
Okay.
Yeah, but that
we hope we'll receive a question.
For comparative purposes, maybe somebody could, because it's been a very complicated question in Georgia, not always a successful solution has been found. Would anybody volunteer to sing on? Would you like to talk about how the financing is done in higher education projects?
In general, there are two types of funding. One is the major part goes through students, so the money follows the students to the university that they choose. It's a very similar system in every country in South Balkans. So the students can choose between private and public, and they can choose during the examinations. Majors that they can apply to, then they're distributed through central examinations to the, according to their scores, to the majors that they prioritize. And then there's another way to fund the universities, which is the government has come up with a list of priorities that they seek the public universities that had that major on all three levels of education based on that system. And PhD, and only those universities get that extra money. And there, as you call them, these are free seats. We don't call them free seats anymore, but it's the same idea. So so most of the money in the higher education journey comes from private sources. These are mostly students paying their own tuitions. Only part of it is financed by the government. Then there is the National Science Foundation, which gives grants to the scientists, as most of the scientists are concentrated in the universities. That's another pool of money that comes into the universities. Obviously, there are international funds, as you also mentioned, Tempus and other grants, IFP7, etc., which also brings some money into the higher education. There is very little money from the private sources that comes from private corporations that come in the forms of scholarships for students. And some students are financed also internally by the universities. They redistribute their money to the students. Some universities came up also with the loan systems that they run internally, which is you do not finance your studies now, but once you finish and start working, then that's when the financing. There was an attempt during 2006-07 to have these loan systems also on the national scale. The banks were together with the Ministry of Education, but it did run for a while, but it was not really successful, so it's not really educational law per se, but it's a
comment. My name is Timothy Blovelt. I'm the country director for American Councils in Jordan. I'm also an associate professor at this university. I've been teaching here at Tbilisi State University for about 12 years or so. And about the issue of students and what they want from university and what they get from it, I think there is a sort of holdover that the most important thing about going to universities is the prestige of being there. The South Caucasus, Georgia, certainly is a very demonstrative culture, and that this prestige is really important. And I've rarely met a student who wanted to go to a university because they saw that as a place of learning or as a place where knowledge is held, and that they felt they wanted to gain the knowledge from going there. It's a hurdle to be passed, it's a certificate to be gained, and it's a prestige of having gained access to it. Maybe also connections with people you might meet there. But I think that it really has a reflection in what students do when they're in the university, that attendance is disastrously poor. It's not unusual for no students at all to show up for a class, for example. Attendance can only be either 10 or 20% of the grade. You can't fail somebody for never showing up to classes. Most students actually have jobs, and so even at the BA level, just it's almost sort of a hobby that they're doing on the side, and that's even more so at the MA level, and completely the case at the PhD level, that it's something that it's a hurdle to be accomplished. And
can I follow on that? Yeah, that was a little bit a part of my question, is that having taught in Yemen in Armenia as a Fulbright scholar, and now teaching in Saudi Arabia, and I'm getting ready to go to Poland next year, and having taught for so many years in the United States, I tell people that I am so surprised that students, regardless of where they are students. They have a different set of, they have a similar set of criteria. In terms of, unfortunately, in the United States, students don't necessarily pick a university because of an academic or whatever. It's a name, it's a prestige. It's quite often it's based on the facilities that those universities offer, either in sports, in dormitories, classroom, technology, background, pedigree of faculty. And the students in the United States, they surprise me at how much research they do on those things. You know, they'll go to a university simply because they have a really good football team, American football team, or they have a very good student athletic center, or something totally that those of us in academia are like totally not on our radar screen. So I guess that was, in talking about the competition between the universities in the United States, that's one thing now that the universities are doing. You know, they're spending money on either teacher salaries to bring in some big name professors. They are spending money on technology because students in the world today, they're very technologically savvy. They learn in a totally different way than many of us learned. And the faculty are expected to be performers to some extent. So that means that we have to spend money on teacher training. And I was just curious if you are finding that same sort of thing, you know, in the universities here, because I think that while a lot of the earlier discussion has been from a top down, a government, you know, international regulations, accreditation, assessment. It's also about what is it that the universities are doing to engage the best and the brightest students. And also from a funding point of view, while I think it's really, you know, a lot of universities in the United States do offer tuition free, but quite often they can't afford to do that because they're competing with, you know, other universities, other states. So I guess the question that I'm really trying to ask now is that, do you see the universities in the Caucasus changing any sort of financial model in terms of student tuition as a way to help the universities increase their funding in some way, because, you know, in today's world, there's other things that I think universities have to do to attract students. So, you know, are you facing these sorts of things? Are students looking at your physical facilities? Are they looking at the quality of the dormitories? Are they looking at the technology? Like for architecture students, are they looking to see if they have a wood shop or some place where they can actually do construction? Because when I was teaching at Yamaha State University, they didn't have anything like that. So, you know, so do you see any changes, like in terms of the fee structure, to where students are going to have to start paying some money so that the universities can start to improve some of the infrastructure to do things to really set themselves apart from each other?
You know, I think that many of Armenian state universities are rather open and are ready to be more attractive for students. As for overseas students, so for local students. Each university has its own priority in this regard. For instance, if you are a medical university and one of the best in the region, maybe it is useless to have a good football team. It's better to cooperate with the best hospitals, with the best professors, for the work which is done by the Yerevan Medical University. So they have links with the best hospitals, not in Armenia, but for instance in Russia as well. And they attract their students by their cooperational programs with Germany, by their program with Russia. So you can have a practice, for instance, in one of the best hospitals in Russia, and this model is works.
So the students can pick the university because they know that when they graduate, they can go be a doctor or do their internship.
Or at least they have the possibility to have a practice, because if no through this university, it would be almost impossible. So this is the issue for me. This is the issue of school management. So you have to know why your university is being selected. Whether it is specialization, whether it is mobility programs, whether it is degree which can be obtained and recognized in another country, whether it is cooperational programs with another university. So we have such experience with, for instance, the Brussels University, by studying Chinese language in Confucius University, which operates within the Brussels University, it is a social language university. You can have some credits in Chinese. So every university provides some opportunities for the students. Unfortunately, in Armenia, the obtaining of higher education for the pupils is a matter of necessity, not choice. Maybe some of them would like to work and then to receive their higher education institution, but you know, it is so used to apply to higher education institution, then somehow to decide what I'm going to be. Or in some cases, there is no strict desire to be a doctor or to be a lawyer. They look what the other choose. So the decision must be done, but in some cases it is done by parents, by the society, but not the people, but not the person himself.
But then do they give any, I think this was mentioned about secondary education, but do the students, do they take aptitude tests to help determine where their strengths are?
We have such kind of procedures. So in the higher schools, we have some kind of tests to identify the real interest of the pupil. Sometimes it differs. So maybe he would be a good lawyer, but he decided to be an IT specialist. But in any case, the legislation gives you possibility. If you obtain, for instance, a master degree in medicine, and then you, a bachelor degree in medicine, and then you decide to continue master in IT, actually it is more difficult to transfer from one specialization to another, but it is possible. So another university which is not so special, professional oriented, for instance, Yaren State University, they are attracted by another programs. For instance, they developed the Faculty of European Studies, which is unique among the Armenian universities. So if you are interested in studying EU studies or EU legislation, they apply actually on master level to that faculty. So whether you are making some connections and links with another universities, whether you are obtaining or applying for new specializations or new instruments, in Russia we have such kind of proverb, so be afraid of your dreams, they can come true. If the university wants to be free, he has to take the responsibility. Sometimes it is easier to follow some ministry's decisions, but if we are in the process of student-oriented education, the student, we just have to support them to make the right decision. And if the decision was not so right, we have to make a possibility to change it. And this is maybe the life of learning formal and informal education.
We have a little bit of flexibility, so Hamlet, if you could answer that question too, and then we have time for one more question.
Thank you. In general, of course, each university has its own priority area, which developing trying to have more quality program than other areas. For instance, in my case, while developing engineering school mainly, because now it's the most attractive majors in Azerbaijan, because if you have good engineering diploma, you will too many international companies, too many Azerbaijani companies, it's much more well paid than law or medicine or So, but the problem is that if you are developing engineering, you have to have world-class labs. It's almost impossible to have world-class labs. Anyway, you have to develop your labs. That's a problem one. Concerning student support system, indeed, in some universities develop a very good student support system, including all international students, psychological, career center, and disabilities, and so on. Maybe even some cases much more good relations with students than in European and American. But problems are, as I said, one labs, another is dormitory. No one university in Azerbaijan has good enough dormitory. If in some cases they have nothing, in other cases dormitory which is not good quality, in third cases it good quality but not enough, very very small. That's very problem. Even one of our state university rectors recently announced in an interview with students that we have all capacity to enter into hundreds best universities, but our dormitory is not so big. Also, scholarship, I think to attract good students, you have to have scholarship program. We have scholarship, good scholarship for students going abroad, but receive our own students, of course, there is government scholarship. If students will come to a private university with good grade, they will receive government scholarship, full scholarship. But it's not enough, particularly attract bright local students, bright international students. So you have to have developed scholarship. it's not so developed in Azerbaijan. If I will say not developed in general. That's the main, I think, problem.
So we have time for one more question. You have a question for us? Thank you, everyone, and have a good lunch, and we'll see you in another hour.